Hey, Nick Thomas here at the 11th Annual National Cyber Summit in Huntsville, Alabama. And I'm sitting here with Mr. Gary Warner. He is the Director of Research at the University of Alabama at Birmingham, their Center for Information Assurance. Welcome, Gary.
Hey, great to be here, Nick.
Hey, nice to have you. So we know you're one of the speakers here today. You've also done a lot of stuff in the past. So can you give me a little intel about what you're doing at UAB?
Yeah, things are really exciting in the lab right now. So I run a cybercrime research lab. We call it the Computer Forensics Research Lab. And we're doing a lot of things beyond what the traditional definitions would imply.
Okay.
A lot of people, when they think computer forensics, they think looking at hard drives. And really what we've extended that to be is forensics means of the courts. So I'm talking cyber forensics or computer forensics, any digital evidence that might be presented in the courts.
So smartphones, down to microchips, anything, right?
But also emails, websites, online forums, social media,
okay.
All of those are additional data sources that we consider to be in the umbrella of computer forensics.
Awesome. Tell me a little bit about the stuff you're doing with Dark Tower, and specifically you were working on a project in FishMe, the company actually bought that piece, is that correct?
Well, about 2012, we rolled a company out of the lab based on our phishing investigations technologies. We had 5 patents that were filed and awarded in various ways of detecting phishing websites.
Mm-hmm.
And we were also doing a lot of work in email-based crimes, specifically about malware. So as new malware came in, we would take it apart, evaluate it, run it a lot of times, get a good
sense. In a sandbox, of course, right?
In a sandbox, yeah. We call it human-driven sandboxing. When you automate malware analysis, a lot of times what will happen when you get your sandbox result, it says, this malware sample talked to this IP address, that's the command and control. Okay, what if that command and control was unavailable?
Right.
Well, the human-driven sandboxing would then take away infrastructure from the malware and say, okay, now where do you go? And basically revealing all of the backup layers.
Okay.
Because what would happen, a company would get this indicator of compromise and say, oh, so we'll block that IOC. Well, the malware just went to its secondary or its tertiary, and it may have had 5 or 6 or 7 different backups that if you only relied on automated sandboxing, you'd get one, and the malware was still totally successful. So that company was called Malcovery Security, and we sold that to FishMe in 2015.
Oh, wow.
And then FishMe added that, they called it their intelligence package. So FishMe's intelligence package was what we did at Malcovery.
Awesome.
After I left FishMe, FishMe was acquired by Cofense, and at that time I went back to the lab, and shortly thereafter we developed a partnership with Dark Tower. The Dark Tower relationship really came out of a desire to help get better placements for our students. So Dark Tower is based in Charlotte, where they have great relationships with a lot of financial services companies that they were already doing work with. Well, those companies were having difficulty finding talent. They knew about my lab, and the original conversations were, how could we streamline some of your students into great opportunities in the financial services industry? But then they said, what if we don't want to wait for them? What if we could engage the lab while they're still in the lab to start working on projects for those companies?
And while they're still in school.
So one of the things in internship programs, a classic internship program, one of the reasons companies engage in internships is they believe that there's a really good chance that if they have this talented student as an intern, they get a chance to check them out. When they graduate, it's kind of a natural thing that people go work for the place they intern.
Right.
Well, this is the same sort of thing. We build intelligence cells in the lab that can service a client's intelligence needs, mostly in social media, but in any online, any area that fits within that cyber forensics bucket that we talked about earlier. So some of the clients are very engaged, talk to us several times a week, formal weekly meeting with deliverables. Others are more like, hey, look for our stuff. If you find anything, let us know, you know? And so it can go from super formal to pretty lax. But the thing is, think about having 5 additional people who are hunting for fraud or threats or risks against your brand, and then think that you're paying them student wages, but they're trained in my lab, so they're probably about the same skill level as someone who's
Absolutely.
Been with your company for several years.
Yeah, and then I would want to hire them after they got out.
Exactly, because now they already know your problem sets, So it kind of becomes a natural workflow that companies are literally engaging in the lab to increase their chance of being able to hire one of our students.
And they'll hit the ground running. So the manpower to come up to where an employee should be is very minimal.
Yeah. You know, there's always some cultural things that we have to learn about. How does that company work on the inside versus as an outsider? But yeah, they hit the ground running. A lot of times they're working real-world investigations within 2 weeks.
Let's talk about some experiential-based learning that you had talked about in your speech today.
Yeah, so that idea, I'll often lecture to the incoming honors students. And these are some of the brightest kids. I mean, they're really great kids. But what they are lacking is direction. And what I tell them is the most important thing for you is to find a problem set that you're passionate about as early as you can in your educational experience, because it changes everything from that point. So as opposed to doing a homework assignment where I'm trying to get an A and do what the teacher said or the professor said, I'm going, wait, actually that might help me with my theory on how I might cure myasthenia gravis or something.
Okay.
You know, it's like,
once
you know what your problem set is, everything you're having the opportunity to learn, you're evaluating on is how could this help with my problem set? And so I challenge the students, learn as early as you can in your educational experience, what is it you want to do? And by coming into my lab, they have the opportunity to say, you know, I don't think I want to be a cybercrime analyst if that's what they do. Or they may say, wow, I'm passionate about this. I'm like, great. Now you see why we're focusing more on these programming techniques or these machine learning techniques could really make you a superstar when you graduate to go be a cybercrime fighter. Oh, yeah. And so it gives them a new passion towards their opportunities as a student when they understand how those things could apply to their career.
So you're talking about a multidisciplinary approach to learning then, right?
Right. So it's not just what you do in the classroom and what you do in your homework. It's having real world opportunities to put those things to practice for real customers, whether they're government agencies or corporations. But on the intelligence side in particular, when we talk about intelligence team building, one of the things you'll hear is you need many different perspectives. You know, if you've got an intel team that's all built from white men from Birmingham, Alabama, they're going to have a certain set of predispositions that are going to taint their ability to see alternative views of the data.
Correct.
You want people who speak many languages, who come from many cultures, and who study different things. So I have kids, they love reading political science and intrigue, and they they know who's running for office in the Czech Republic next semester in their term in their Senate elections, whereas a computer scientist can't even name 10 countries in Europe sometimes.
Right,
you
right.
know, and well, if I'm trying to put together intelligence packages that are about foreign influence operations, for example, foreign governments trying to sway our election. Well, you need to be politically aware to be able to analyze that data. So having a political science student or a world...
That's not even a cyber guy or
an international
girl.
Business student
right.
on the team really helps us with that. Then the other thing is UAB is one of the most diverse universities in the whole country. I think they said we speak 106 languages at
wow.
UAB. So I had an opportunity where one of our clients was working on hate speech in Burma.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, oh, we wish...
We could speak Burmese?
I wish there was someone that could help us with this. I'm like, well, we have a history professor whose dissertation was on ethnic conflicts in Myanmar. And why don't we just bring him onto the team? And so we brought Professor Womack over, and he mentored the team, helped them understand who the players were in the ethnic map of Myanmar,
mm-hmm.
and then was available in a WhatsApp chat to advise them as they came across, hey, we need somebody who really understands what's going on the ground in Myanmar to help us understand, are these the bad guys or the good guys?
Wow.
and we can deliver those kind of services. You know, when the Sri Lanka attacks went down recently, one of our clients was like, we really need to know what are some hate terms or slurs that people might be casting towards certain ethnic groups in Sri Lanka. Well, we went over to the International House and we're like, hey, who do we have that speaks the languages of Sri Lanka? And they hooked us up with some. We brought them into the lab for a few days, interviewed them, talked to them, got our hunt set. Okay, now the cyber kids know what they're looking for.
Yeah.
Thanks for your service. You can go on. But some of those situations, we had chemistry kids who came up to help us learn the terms for fentanyl and opioids. And
oh, the street terms and every...
Well, the chemical terms.
The chemical terms.
If they're selling it by the chemical equation, how's one of my cyber kids going to know, oh, that chemical equation is fentanyl?
Know that.
Or, well, you can tell that's a hallucinogen, not a pain medicine, because look at this structure. We wouldn't know any of that. But we brought the chemists up, and they helped us build our collection plan. Some of them got so excited about it, they're like, could I learn that cyber stuff too? And we frequently will have that happen, where someone will get a bachelor's degree in chemistry and then come get a master's in computer forensics because they've had the opportunity to work in the lab and they're passionate about the problem set. A lot of them will go on to be a crime scene investigator or something like that if their undergrad was chemistry or biology and they're interested in this stuff. They're like, now I'm a crime scene investigator who can do the digital evidence and the trace evidence.
So that's a good way of scaling cyber techniques that you guys are doing at UAB there.
Yeah, it's working quite well.
All right. So
the lab is growing like crazy. You mentioned the Dark Tower partnership.
Right, right.
So we went from 2 years ago having 35 students in the lab. Last year we got up to about 50. We're at 90, and we'll probably cross to over 100 by July 1. And all contracted students, every one of them's working for either a corporation or a government agency under contract.
And a lot of this word of mouth on campus, like, hey, you should really go by and check this out, or?
Well, the original recruiting method was you had to get an A in one of my classes, and then I would offer you a gig.
Right.
But I realized I was limiting my scope by doing that. I'm only hiring digital forensics students.
Right.
And if I wanted to broaden that, I needed to bring in people from other disciplines. So yeah, a lot of it is word of mouth. We'll say, hey, we do open houses at the beginning of each semester. Hey, bring a resume and your transcript. If you've got a 3.0 and are interested in cybercrime or cyber intelligence, come spend some time in our lab, learn what we do, and then if you want, stay for an interview.
And it's helping out with your students being hired, right? He was telling me earlier about some of your students being hired at a company, and...
Yeah. I mean, well, yeah, we had some of our students went to work for one of the banks that we'd been doing phishing work with, and the bank had cautioned, you know, well, it may be a couple months before they'll actually get to work on real cases, and they called and apologized to me afterwards, and they said, you know, the students have only been here 2 weeks, and we just had them do a training for our current staff on how to do phishing investigations, because... there's a couple parts to that. They had experience working on phishing with multiple financial institutions. So they weren't just bringing our perspective, they were actually bringing
perspective
all of the financial sector that had the opportunity to work with.
Yeah, so that was a great pat on the back for you.
Yeah, it was nice.
All right, well, Gary, thanks so much for stopping by.
Hey, Nick, it was great.
Thanks.